So it's actually a great pleasure for us to introduce Dr. Lee Orff to give the MME Distinguished Lecture. As you can see, he comes from the Meteorological Satellite Studies in the University of Wisconsin. And I'm going to let Professor Savory give a more formal introduction, as he knows him quite a bit more better than I do.
For better or for worse.
I'm delighted to be able to welcome and introduce Lee to you. I've worked with him for the last 10 years on topics relating to severe storms, from my perspective, the application to engineering structures. And Lee started out at the University of Wisconsin-Madison with his PhD, went on to be a faculty member at the University of North Carolina, and then for 12 years, not too far away, at Central Michigan University. And recently he's returned to the University of Wisconsin-Madison to this center here to pursue his research in numerical simulation of severe storms using high-performance computing. So unlike other people who like to go out and chase storms and put themselves in harm's way, he prefers to stay indoors and make his own storms. So if you look at the front cover of this month's edition of the Bulletin of the American Meteorological Society, you'll see a beautiful picture of one of these simulations in a landmark paper that has been published on the work he's going to be talking about today. And I'm sure you'll find his talk not only interesting, but perhaps full of some of the most amazing graphics you will have ever seen in a presentation in this department or anywhere else. So please really welcome Lee to our...
Thank you so very much for the invite and coming out here. It's my second visit to London, and it's a real pleasure to come here and share my research with you today. As Eric said, I've been working on this for a little while. He and I have worked together for a little while, and I'll give you a little taste of some of the work we've done in this talk. But I'm mostly going to focus on recent simulation results from what we call, I guess, ultra-high-resolution simulations. And it's funny, when you read the meteorological literature, it used to be high, then very high, now it's ultra. So if I go to higher resolution, I'm going to have to borrow adjectives from another language, I think. But I do want to mention my collaborators here. Robert Wilhelmsen is one of the pioneers of cloud modeling, who did work in the 70s that was landmark work in the 70s in getting supercells to be simulated. And at the time, supercomputers, which were quite small, and less functionality than maybe a smartphone today. But he really started this ball going. I've been doing collaborative work with him since the 2000s when I was at UNC Asheville. And we've sort of been, this is sort of a long collaboration that has now borne some good fruit. Bruce Lee and Kathy Finley are two meteorologists who have worked in private industry, have done numerical modeling work, and storm chasing. So one of the critical aspects from Kathy and Bruce is to bring my eyes to the real atmosphere and compare field work to our numerical results, because you don't want to talk about modeling results without some sort of reality check, right? So I sort of thought I would come up with what's my broad research agenda. I do several different things, but mostly I want to simulate thunderstorm-related phenomena. It could be actual storms, it could be pieces of storms like downbursts, at the highest spatial resolution possible using modern supercomputing hardware. So, of course, modern supercomputing hardware changes over time, and it's not just for fun, although I have to admit some of it actually is fun to make these simulations and get some interesting science out of them. But the truth is, some of the flow features that are important to things like tornado genesis, the formation of tornadoes, and also the maintenance and the dissipation of tornadoes, involve vortices that are on the order of maybe tens of meters. 10 to say 20 meters. These vortices show up in nature. We've seen these in Doppler radar data, but we're seeing them in the simulation. And I would argue that if you can't resolve some of these smaller scale features, you're not going to get the energy budget right, and you're not going to get the tornado forming correctly. I'm also very interested in visualization with very high fidelity. I've been doing work with volume rendering techniques that have worked pretty well. This sort of ties back to my advisor, who was John Anderson at the University of Wisconsin. He went on to work for Industrial Light and Magic. He did work on The Perfect Storm. He did work on the Star Wars movies. And he went to Pixar and did all this stuff. My point being, some of that graphical stuff was infused in me, and I still do it today. Of course, as a scientist, I want to know why supercells produce tornadoes, why others don't, and especially why some produce these really long-track monster tornadoes. That's the really important thing. But I'm also, on the engineering side of things, the work I've done with Eric, I'm interested in using simulation data, of full physical simulation data, in conjunction with or maybe even in place of some of the more highly idealized models used in the wind engineering community. We've done this with downbursts. We continue to do this. And I would challenge some of you, perhaps, to think if we can think of ways that we could perhaps use simpler models, but not as simple as some of the ones that are used today for tornado chamber models, to try to model this type of work without having to use a supercomputer. So why do we study these types of storms? Well, the truth is the large majority of fatalities and damage that goes along with it occur in these high-end EF4 to EF5 strength tornadoes. EF refers to the Enhanced Fujita Scale, and it's a scale that is based upon damage indicators. A whole lot of engineering went into that Enhanced Fujita Scale. Essentially, we don't have the luxury of being able to sample tornadoes throughout their lives, but we do have the grim reality of having to clean up after them, and by looking at the damage patterns that are left behind, Ted Fujita, a pioneer in this type of work at the University of Chicago in the 60s and 70s, came up with a scale to help us try to intuit what kind of winds cause the damage we see. Long track tornadoes, just by virtue of the length of the track, have more potential to cause more damage. And despite advances in both observational and numerical techniques, we still really don't know why some supercells produce these types of high-end storm tornadoes and why other ones produce very transient, weak tornadoes or no tornado at all. And this is really the focus where we want to go here. A few words about non-tornadic thunderstorms. Under certain environmental conditions, air mass thunderstorms or ordinary run-of-the-mill thunderstorms can actually produce damaging wind that get into the tornado strength. So winds in excess of, say, 80 meters per second. That's a high end, but it can happen. So these events are called downbursts. They have been the focus of both observational modeling studies, as in the downburst model that Eric just showed me that you guys have here, and also numerical models. These events do cause tornadic damage in some cases, and I reference you to a paper that we worked on to sort of take a full cloud model and try to understand what's going on to lead to these downbursts. And I'll share with you a figure from that article. In this case, I'm volume rendering the cloud and the rain separately. And as you can see, you have this cloud. This is a normal air mass, sort of a Denver-style thunderstorm, meaning a very deep, well-mixed boundary layer with just enough moisture to kick off a cloud like this. If you produce precipitation in the cloud, rain and snow and hail, that rain and that will, the snow and the hail will melt to form rain. And when that rain hits this very, very dry, well-mixed layer, it evaporates. That evaporation leads to cooling. You have a dense pocket of air. It sinks to the ground, spreads out, and causes a downburst. And there's ways you can get rid of the cloud and just have that by some of the techniques for the simpler models. Here's a movie of the potential temperature of that simulation I just showed, watching the cold blobs of air descend from the cloud, hit the ground, and spread out. This was done by Rob Cisneros at NCSA. This is where the strongest winds are found. We're going to highlight the cold pool region of the storm, and we're going to focus on the region right here where you see the strongest transient winds. As you can see, it's pretty messy. It's not nice and smooth like some of our simpler simulations, but this type of simulation or this type of event can cause some very strong winds. I do want you to pay attention at least to the concept of the cold pool. Supercells have cold pools, and most of the interesting things that occur in our simulations occur along the boundary between this denser air, the colder, denser air, and the environmental air ahead of it. So one of the things to take away from this is that baroclinicity or density variations in the horizontal are extremely important to getting the physics right, and chamber models don't have that. But this is the kind of storm we really want to simulate, okay? So here we have this supercell thunderstorm with this big wedge tornado on the ground. This is the mesocyclone of the storm as a rotating updraft extending to maybe up to the tropopause at 16 kilometers above the ground. This region here is called the forward flank of the storm. We break supercells into sort of flanks, the forward flank being sort of this part of the storm and the rear flank being back here. The storm is propagating to the right in this case. This would be looking towards the northwest. It doesn't show up too well, but there's a lot of rain falling here. This is the forward flank that causes the forward flank cold pool region, the forward flank gust front region. The rear flank over here has its own associated cold pool as well. And I will show you a more of a schematic diagram, but this is the kind of storm we're wanting to simulate. And also your eyes should focus your eyes on this band of clouds here. And you see how it sort of turns up and into where the mesocyclone is? Now, I'm not sure that this is actually what we're seeing in our model, but we see a feature that looks similar to this in our simulations, and I'll share that with you shortly. Here is a snapshot from our simulation. So this is volume rendered cloud. There's what looks like a tiny little tornado, but I do these diagrams to give you a sense of the scale of these events. These are big storms. You really do have to capture all the stuff up here at high resolution in order for the stuff that causes this to form correctly. So you really do need supercomputers to do this kind of a work. So you need supercomputers. You need a good numerical model that can actually exploit these supercomputers, and that's not trivial. George Bryan, he's at the National Center for Atmospheric Research in Boulder, Colorado. He has a model that he's created that I use extensively. I've used it for years. You need to have a good set of initial conditions. In this case, we used a model forecast, a one-hour model forecast, the RUC model, Rapid Update Cycle model. It's one of our operational models in the States where we actually try to assimilate as much data as possible quickly and make short-term forecasts. We plucked a sounding out of that and used that, and it worked. You need lots of hardware and software infrastructure. I've done a lot of work here. I'm not here to talk about that, but much of my time has been spent just managing data, terabytes and terabytes of data. And you do need a bit of luck, let's face it. When you go out to do an actual storm chase, you don't know if you're going to see a tornado. When you do one of these simulations, you don't know if you're going to see a tornado. And I've done many of these simulations. They're extremely sensitive to environmental conditions and also parameters in the model. Here's a schematic of a supercell. You can sort of think of that other image in your head when you look at this. This is the forward flank region of the storm. This is the forward flank gust front or downburst front. There's different terms for this. I call it the forward flank downdraft boundary because it's not much of a gust front in our simulation. Here's where you'd expect the tornado to form. Here's the rear flank of the storm. These boundaries are where we'll be focusing much of our time because most of the action is occurring along these boundaries. Big rotating updraft, that's the mesocyclone, and the associated downdraft. These supercells occur in environments which are very unstable and contain lots of environmental wind shear. So the winds are changing with height quite dramatically as you ascend in the atmosphere. This is actually a simulation based on a true event. This is Doppler radar data from the actual event that went through El Reno, Oklahoma on 24 May 2011. This is showing you the couplet you'd expect from a Doppler radar signature, showing strong rotation. And here is the hook region. This storm is sort of embedded in the line of storms, unlike our storm. Here's a debris ball from the tornado right in that thing there. This one was a pretty high-end storm, and our simulation is pretty faithfully reproducing many of its effects. This is the same type of radar reflectivity image, but taken from model data. We're focusing right here. The tornado is going to be right in that region there. Let's zoom in a little bit so we can see it better. And here is, this is our tornado shortly after it is formed. You'll see in the simulation an anti-cyclonic tornado that forms as well, a much weaker kind of transient comes and goes. That's going to be the focus of future study, but the tornado here is where we're going to be focusing our time. This is shortly after it forms, when things really haven't gotten too crazy yet. So, we configured the model. I know you guys might have some questions about the parameters. I don't know if I'll have time to talk about them too much. We're using fifth order horizontal and vertical advection. So that's the order of accuracy of the advection portion of the code. Hugh Morrison's microphysics, it's dual moment. It means that there's more degrees of freedom. We have droplet breakup, number concentration as a prognostic variable. It's a better way to do microphysics. Hugh Morrison's also at NCAR. Turbulence closure, we have two options for CM1. The simulation I'm going to spend most of my time with uses Smagorinsky closure, which you might raise your eyebrows at. It's a diagnostic turbulence closure. The reason we used it is because it worked. That's really the answer. And I could go on at length about all these parameters. Free slip surface boundary conditions with a little asterisk there. We may have a tiny bit of friction from the turbulence closure. We're still trying to figure out the implications of that, but it's essentially free slip. A very short time step because of the strong velocities. And we trigger the storm by poking, make that noise. No, it's an updraft. You just push the air up to get the storm going. To give you an idea of the size of the problem, the 30-meter simulation that I'll spend most of my time talking about, 1.8 billion grid points. The 20-meter simulation, almost 8 billion grid points. That's a lot of grid points, especially when you're saving data every one model second and you're saving, say, 4,000 time steps. You get towards petabytes of data on these simulations. Okay. So we'll get into the good stuff pretty soon. Just an overview of a storm. It produces an EF5 strength tornado for just under 2 hours of time, uninterrupted. We see all sorts of small-scale vortices in abundance along some of these boundaries I've talked about. They merge. They seem to provide vorticity to the tornado. They accumulate. And again, the videos will show this better than I can explain it. We also have we've identified a structure we're calling the streamwise vorticity current that seems to be an important feature that helps to take air from near the ground that contains horizontal vorticity and tilt it into the vertical where it can help to keep the mesocyclone spinning that's sort of driving the whole thing. So the remainder of this talk will be cover simulation results. Question for you guys that I sort of mentioned earlier. Okay, so we have a supercomputer here doing a full physics simulation. It takes some, you know, million core hours or whatnot. We can't do that for all of our simulations. So is there, can we create a simpler model that captures some of the complexity that we'll be seeing shortly without too much compromise? And I'm telling you, it can't be barotropic, okay? We can't have a chamber simulation where there's no horizontal density gradients, because that seems to drive most of the stuff. So can we create a model that can actually handle that? So let's look at the genesis. So genesis is the tornado's formation. This is, for obvious reasons, I think, a pretty important thing for meteorologists to determine, because it's one thing to see a storm pop up on radar, but when and where the tornado forms is going to determine where the damage path is, et cetera. So convective initiation is one thing, where the storm forms, but being able to actually, the processes that go into genesis, are there things we can identify in radar data before the tornado forms so that we can make a good forecast and get people warned and out of the way? The tornado that forms, forms from many cyclonic vortices. You'll see this in the movies. One thing that's, I think, pretty important is that the vortex that forms the tornado sort of forms almost simultaneously along its length. You don't see like it descending from the mesocyclone down to the ground like a dynamic pipe or something like that. It's actually not like that. This genesis that we see in our simulation is very similar to what was observed for the event we're simulating, so that's pretty gratifying. So here's our storm, kind of giving a sense of scale. Here's our model domain, 120 kilometers on a side, 20 kilometers deep, just to sort of give you a scale where we have to fit this monster storm. And as we zoom in, we can see more and more of the detail. There's a figure from earlier. Here is sort of a snapshot of the point of genesis here up on the top. So here's shortly after the tornado forms. So the actual tornado funnel you can see descending to the ground, but the vortex is in place long before that condensation funnel descends. Early on, we have this interesting little sort of a rain curtain that envelops the wall cloud and the tornado, which these things have been seen in radar data. You see something suggesting rotational flow in the wall cloud. A meteorologist might call this a stovepipe or a wedge tornado. There's all sorts of fun slang for tornadoes. And here we have a rain-wrapped wedge. You know, you don't want to have to chase one of these because you can get caught in the rain and you can't see what the heck's going on. It's very dangerous. So here's different stages of the vorticity throughout different portions of the simulation. CV stands for cyclonic vortex. They're red. The tornado is cyclonic. It's rotating the way you'd expect, counterclockwise in the northern hemisphere. But there's plenty of anticyclonic vortices as well. You'll see the interaction between the anticyclonic vortices and the tornado are quite fascinating. Whereas these cyclonic vortices will just sort of be assimilated into the tornado and adding to its rotation or its circulation, the anticyclonic vortices, it's like holding two magnets, you know, North Pole to each other. It fights with the tornado. The tornado ends up taking it and tilting it into the horizontal and lifting it up and advecting it as if it's a thing. So that vortex you just saw, it got tilted on its side. It's a horizontal vortex now. It's like a hairpin. It's going to go advected up around the tornado, and it gets pretty messy, as you can see. We see a lot of different stuff going on. So I'll be focusing a lot of my attention on the forward flank of the storm. That would be right about here, where these vortices are accumulating and apparently providing a lot of vorticity to the supercell. But one other feature I'll talk about is what we're calling a streamwise vorticity current. Streamwise vorticity is vorticity that is aligned along, the vorticity vector is aligned in the exact same direction as the velocity vector. And the nice thing about streamwise vorticity is if you have a current of streamwise vorticity and you lift it into the vertical, it's rotating cyclonically, and it's going to inject that rotation into the mesocyclone of the supercell. The mesocyclone, big rotating updraft, is basically the engine for the whole storm. And how the mesocyclone interacts with the tornado is something that's fascinating and we'll be looking at. Something similar to a vertical vortex sheet is occurring along this boundary, but it's not a classic horizontal shearing instability where you'd expect all the vortices to have the same sign, all to be cyclonic or anticyclonic. You have a mixture. So it's not a true vortex sheet in the true sense of the term, but it's something similar to that. So this is sort of that vortex right there is going to become our tornado, and there's a whole parade of vortices sort of coming in there to join the party, some of which are going to merge and help that tornado go, and this one is the anticyclonic one. So let's run this movie. This is the three-dimensional streamlined vorticity field volume rendered. We're calling this a vortex sheet, streamlined vorticity sheet. It really does look aligned the way you'd expect, and this is the streamlined vorticity current. So this is sort of our bundle of vorticity that's going straight into the mesocyclone. This oscillating blob is the pressure deficit. It oscillates because of gravity waves in the domain, and there's our tornado forming. The SVC seems to lead to some of that pressure drop that's occurring. So here's a snapshot in time, again, of the three-dimensional streamlined vorticity. I'll zoom in a little bit. So here is the tornado, which certainly contains a lot of streamlined vorticity, but here's that SVC thing, which is separate from the tornado. So we have what looks like a very efficient mechanism for taking some of this horizontal vorticity that's generated by this baryclinicity due to the buoyancy gradients and organizing it in such a way, you know, it's rotating helically and it's bringing this vertical vorticity into the mesocyclone. And mesocyclones are all about vertical vorticity, right? So it seems like a really interesting way of getting vertical vorticity into the mesocyclone to help drive the whole simulation. So we're calling this the streamwise vorticity current. And we've given it a name. You always got to be careful when you give something a name because hopefully it's there in nature as well. So in this long sequence, I'm coloring the vorticity magnitude by the vertical component. So for instance, just to freeze it here, this would be an anticyclonic vertical vortex. So red ones are cyclonic. And when you see gray like this, that's horizontal. So I'm shading it by the vertical component where there's virtually no vertical vorticity. It's all horizontal. You still see it, it's just gray. But this is a good way to show how the vorticity is being tilted. You can just see it happening. It goes from gray to red, that means you have vortex tilting. It's bringing it into the vertical where it then becomes part of the mesocyclone. And exactly how that all works is uncertain. This is the cold pool. Here's the forward flank. We're going to sort of look at these at the same time to see what's going on. This is the rear flank, where meteorologists spend an awful lot of time looking at the rear flank of the storm because they think that perhaps what goes on in the rear flank of the storm helps trigger tornado genesis. This simulation, the real star is the forward flank of the storm. I'm not saying the rear flank has nothing to do with it, but as you'll see, it's this energy that seems to be playing a more important role. So now I'll just take a zoom in here, and what you'll see eventually is this mess of anticyclonic vorticity off to the left will sort of clear out, and it seems to sort of set the stage for one of these red guys to become our tornado. And again, a video is worth 10,000 words. I suppose I can shut up and just let the video roll, but keep your eyes on right about here where you'll see the tornado form. Things are kind of coming together. You're seeing more consolidation of vortices, and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, boom. So it's not like there's a trigger or a pulse that leads to that, at least that I've discovered yet, that leads to that tornado. It seems to be a slow consolidation process that sort of ramps things up. And we have done some calculations. We're still in the early phase of this work of doing quantitative analysis, but we have done some analysis in these, the advection, the movement of these cyclonic vortices is providing a significant amount of rotation to the tornado. So I think one of the things that we can take away from this is that we need to be out there in the field looking for these little vortices, because I really do think they play an important role. And this just goes on and on. You can sort of see how this is helical. Well, it's hard to do this, but it's kind of going like this, and it goes up. It's got beautiful streamlined vorticity doing rotating and moving in the same way. And the cold pool gets all crazy. You see lots of linear features here that seem to be associated with boundary layer rolls, horizontal rolls. It gets crazy, but it's beautiful. I could watch this all day, and I might even admit that I have on some days, but So the simulation itself, if you're wondering, this simulation probably took about 2 days on Blue Waters to run, and about I'd say half a day to render all those frames. And that's actually kind of amazing. But when you have a supercomputer with 780 or 800,000 cores on it, you can do this kind of work. So going through Genesis again, sort of step by step, trying to go back to the initial part where we start to see the tornado, I went back as far as I could to find that one vortex that I had annotated by arrows. That one seems to be the one to keep your eye on. So we'll go ahead. Again, I'm coloring vorticity magnitude by the vertical component. So we'll try to step through here. We see this red guy getting a little redder. It's accumulating more vorticity. Here's an anticyclonic vortex that kind of just comes in from the rear flank and kind of wraps around. It comes and goes. You'll notice that we're accumulating more vorticity along this length. It's sort of sweeping in from above. but it's very, and there's a whole line of vortices here. 1, 2, 3, count them. Some are cyclonic, some are anticyclonic, and then there's our tornado. And this is the location of the SVC. It's also in the other images, but I just wanted to highlight it. So again, what story does this tell? Right? We would love to have a nice simple story like, oh, there was this big strong downdraft that just kicked off the tornado and off we went to the races. But it's the story here is there's a lot of small scale, very chaotic flow occurring along the forward flank downdraft boundary that seems to be accumulating and until some sort of critical threshold is reached, I don't know, and then we get our tornado. And here we're just going to let parcels go that are near the surface throughout the genesis portion of the storm. This really highlights the fact that the updraft is extremely strong, very close to the ground. So these parcels are being released about, I would say, around 50 meters above the ground. And the updraft is strong enough that it's peeling them off the ground, and it's yanking them into the vertical, and you're tilting a lot of vorticity. Okay, that's maybe the main thing. So here's our brand new tornado. Here's some of the evidence of the SVC sort of wrapping around it. And here's that anticyclonic guy. This is the rear flank of the storm, the rear flank gust front, and this is the forward flank. And I'm coloring the parcels by the wind speed. So these guys are, the blue guys are moving slower, storm relative, to these guys that are moving much faster, just to sort of give you an idea. And there seems to be sort of like in this cold pool region, these parcels are moving much faster. I think it has to do with the fact that there's a big pressure deficit associated with the SVC that's causing the pressure gradient to be stronger. And it's accelerating the air to tornado strength from just like what you would consider straight, you know, horizontal winds as they feed the tornado. And I've been looking at lots of video footage. I don't chase storms, but I do watch a lot of footage. And sometimes you'll see some of the most damage occurring, the air that's coming in to fill the void of a tornado. It's behind the tornado. That air is moving at very, very, very high velocities. Here's just to give you a sense of scale. Shortly after the condensation funnel hits the ground of how big this thing is, it's about 400 meters above the ground at this point. The base of the main cloud is about 650 meters, probably near the lifting condensation level. And the tail cloud is a bit lower to the ground, ostensibly due to the mixing of the air that's been cooled from the outflow of the storm. Here's a movie showing it. Genesis again, just the cloud and rain field. Here's that tail cloud. These little oscillations here are those vortices. Keep your eyes peeled right here. There's our tornado. There it is, Genesis. Curtain of rain. There's that curtain of rain that kind of scooted around from the outside. Beautiful. I saw that. It was so cool when I first saw that. I thought that was neat. I've seen that in radar data. You can see some evidence of rotation of, you know, maybe some little vortices in the wall cloud of the storm. I talked to Howie Bluestein, who's a tornado chaser, one of the pioneers of that, and he says he's seen that in the field as well. So that's, I like to talk to the observational folks, because if my model looks wrong, then I have to go back to the drawing board. So far, no one has told me that this looks wrong. So that's good. And as you can see, it gets wider, it gets nastier looking, it gets... you see a lot of aliasing because I'm saving data every 2 seconds in this image, but there's an awful lot going on. And again, can we model this in a simpler way? I'm not sure. Maybe we can. So the maintenance phase, this would be the portion of the storm where the tornado is churning along. We very rarely have we had the opportunity to study the maintenance phase because most of the tornadoes that have been simulated in the past haven't lasted very long. So this is, I'm only going to touch on this a little bit. The tornado maintains a two-celled structure, meaning that the tornado has a downdraft in the center of it throughout its length. The cold pool and the streamlined vorticity current that I've talked about a bit, it's not very steady. There's a lot of modulations, a lot of pulses going on, but there are portions of the simulation where things kind of calm down. It looks like we might be able to come up with a conceptual model. The RFD, the rear flank of the storm, very turbulent, very sporadic downdrafts occurring there. Some of the downdraft air seems to originate from very high because it's very dry. And we're going to be looking at the source of that low theta E air. And the anticyclonic vortices, as you've seen in some of the movies, are disruptive to the tornado. So let me talk a little bit about this SVC thing here. So here's a plan view of radar reflectivity. There's our tornado. And I've tried to impose the SVC, which is a very three-dimensional feature, sort of project it to the two-dimensional plane to see what it would look like if you were looking at, say, radar imagery. So this is the forward flank downdraft boundary region, and here's the SVC, which is in the cold air, a little behind that boundary. And let me now show you the three-dimensional version of it. And I'll zoom in. So here's trying to show this and this. Notice the camera angle for the 3D view is from the northwest looking towards the southeast. So let's go in. There's our SVC. You can see the way I've left the parcels go. I mean, you can see it with your eyes. You can tell that it's rotating, right? I mean, it's right there. These are unsteady parcels. These are not streamlines. These are being let go every 2 seconds. So you're actually following the parcels of the air. And not only does the SVC, is it like a helical flow, but it occurs to me that it's also traveling in sort of a helical direction around the tornado. And I show that it kind of shows up in this image where I just kind of move the box around, right? So here you have this thing with this helical streamlined vorticity, and it's also moving in a helical pattern. So I don't know what that means, but there's a, you know, a lot of, I think Mother Nature just likes to rotate is what I've decided. Here's another nice image. This is done by David Bach at NCSA. I gave him my data. There's the model mesh, sort of showing you we do have some stretching. Impose the storm. This is just the cloud field. Tilt it up so we can see. Here's the overshooting top of the storm, the anvil. Look at the underside and go, oh, cool, we've got Mimatus clouds, right? And we're probably doing something right. And let this one go. This will show up a little bit better. I'll post this talk online after it's done, but you can see it on your computers. But this looks really good. I mean, this David has done some really interesting things with his shadowing and his volume rendering techniques. But this makes me think we're on the right path, okay? If I can't get a storm to look like a real storm, I've done something wrong because Mother Nature's never wrong. Here I am releasing those parcels again, trying to highlight the streamlined vorticity current. This is that forward flank downdraft boundary. Here's all our baroclinicity that's causing horizontal vorticity. And up and up, it's being sucked into this low pressure region, being tilted and up, and it's not the tornado. It actually stays about a kilometer away from the tornado when it's elevated. So it's not directly feeding the tornado, but it seems to be feeding the mesocyclone with a lot of vertical vorticity that I think is really important to just keep this storm going. There are times when this regime sort of fades away, you don't see a lot of vorticity here, but tornado continues. So I don't think you need to have a streamwise vorticity current to have a tornado, but in this simulation, it plays a key role in the genesis and the maintenance of it. So here again, I'm coloring vorticity magnitude by the vertical components. So the red guys are cyclonic, the blue guys are anticyclonic. Just walking through a little bit of the maintenance phase, it looks a lot like the genesis phase, doesn't it? We've got lots of a whole parade of vortices. Some are red, some are blue. I really like being able to color the full vorticity field by the vertical component because you can see the full vorticity field, but to meteorologists, whether it's rotating cyclonic or anticyclonically is very important. So this is about an hour and a half into the simulation, or getting closer to 2 hours. I'll just step through a few slides. This is from our paper. Here we are again. It looks about the same. All this, the SVC behind and the little vortices along the front, sort of wrapping up into these vortices. At this frame right here is taken at the peak winds of the entire simulation near the ground, 143 meter per second storm relative winds. Okay, ground relative would be even higher. At the interface of the tornado and a little anticyclonic tornado. So it's kind of like you get these gears, it's giving it a little kick, I think. This event lasts about 10 seconds where you see this big pulse of winds going from, say, 130 to 143 and back down again. And 40 minutes later, this is the simulation. It's not a whole lot different. We still have the same general regime. The SVC has gotten weaker. You're not seeing as many of these vortices, but here's our tornado. Now, one thing that does happen as the simulation progresses is the tornado gradually becomes more and more backed up into the cold air, like going backward into the cold pool. And so it's no longer along a boundary between the environmental air and the cold pool air. It's sort of surrounded by cold air. And I think that is one of the things that leads to its demise. So here's the, again, vorticity colored by the vertical component. This is the vertical component of the wind showing the downdraft in the two-cell tornado. And this is pressure deficit. So we're looking at pressure, the pressure that you'd expect. Of course, a tornado is a region of very low pressure. But this lobe of low pressure here is associated with the SVC. So I'm thinking that there's some cyclostrophic pressure drops from that helical flow that's leading to this lobe here. And when you have this really low pressure, this goes all the way to the ground, we're talking like 15 hectopascals pressure deficit at the ground, that's going to cause a strong gradient, a pressure gradient, and it's like that vacuum is going to be filled, in a sense, with those very strong winds. So a lot of stuff going on in the simulation. You can see the twin intertwined vortices, part of the two-cell structure. So in the center of these two vortices that are vigorously rotating, You have a down draft. And that was an important, it was very good that we saw that in our simulation data, because that's the way all the chamber simulations have shown. With when you have a large swirl ratio or a larger swirl ratio, you get the two-celled thing, and we got that. It doesn't start out as a two-celled tornado. It starts out as a one-celled tornado with an updraft throughout its length, but it does transition over. Let's let some parcels go. So, you know, I'm just coloring these parcels by the region where they're originating. This is along the forward flank downdraft boundary, so this is SEC air. This is getting deeper into the cold pool, deeper yet, and going over to the forward flank and the rear flank. And, you know, just trying to get a conceptual model. Look at the amount of wind shear in this layer of air. Notice how all these layers are kind of spreading out already horizontally. And then they get really tilted, and boom, that's a tornado. This is the air that's feeding the tornado. It's in the cold pool. I think that's an important result as well. Generally speaking, the wisdom in meteorology is it's harder to lift cold air than warm air, and that's true. I'm just showing this one more time. But it turns out, I think, the tornado, in this simulation, the tornado contains almost no air from the environment. It's almost all from the cold pool. And I haven't done enough trajectories yet to say that for sure, but if I let parcels go here, they go up. Okay, they do go up in the updraft, but they don't really interact with the tornado at all. So there's like a Goldilocks phenomenon. You want the cold pool to be cooler than the environment, but not so cold that it's too hard to lift the air and things fail. So there, and this, that term has actually been used in some papers, the Goldilocks phenomenon of getting the cold pool right. Here, I'm just releasing particles in a horizontal plane to letting them go in the tornado to show that indeed there's a downdraft and this air recirculates upwards. So these parcels are essentially trapped in the tornado, and then they get evicted upwards when they come out. Here's that fourth. This is just vorticity magnitude. Red is cyclonic, blue is anticyclonic just at the surface. Here's our tornado, anticyclonic. I won't let this go. I mean, I'll sort of jump ahead a little bit, but you can see all this vorticity that's accumulating, and a lot of it's being fed right into the tornado. The blue guys occasionally will shake the tornado up a little bit. You'll see that shortly. You can see how the tornado's getting sort of pulled into the cold air more. You're getting more contributions from the rear flank of the storm. And right about here, keep your eyes on this one here. Look at what happens. It gets wrapped around, it goes around twice or so, and it kind of kicks the tornado aside, and it actually weakens it quite a bit following that event. It's not apparent in this image, but it does get weaker. But this is where I focus most of my attention. This is where the SDC is aloft and all this vorticity coming in. Then our rear flank kicks out a huge downdraft, and a lot of it gets into the tornado. But all good things must come to an end. The tornado does die. It's funny, when I first ran the simulation, I was so excited with my results, I just didn't finish the simulation. So I wasn't sure if this tornado was ever going to die. It laid on disk for 6 months before I let it, so it was in limbo. But anyway, what happens, you'll see this, it gets engulfed in rain, it gets more sort of drawn into the cold pool. The forward flank cold pool actually gets warmer. So it's sort of counterintuitive. You warm up the air that's going to feed the tornado, you'd think that would maybe help because it's easier to lift warm air, but it actually, I think it breaks all this structure that we have that's been driving the whole thing from the start. These density gradients, they go away, and the tornado falls apart. You see a breakdown of the streamwise vorticity sheet that was focused near the ground in the cold pool and the SVC aloft, and it happens very quickly. So I will show that. This is the updraft. Blue is downdraft. This is reflectivity. The tornado is an isosurface of vorticity that you see here. So focus on the blues here. So these are downdrafts, the blue volume-rendered surface. You know, things are going along pretty well, but suddenly you see a whole lot of blue, and it just gets stomped on. Boom, and it's a downburst. There's actually a downburst there. It lasts about 30 seconds, and the tornado is gone. This method of tornado dissipation has been seen in the atmosphere, but generally speaking, this is a convenient vortex to be on the screen while I show this. Many tornadoes seem to get undercut by the cold air and get stretched out, roped out, the rope phase of a tornado, and dissipate. This one doesn't do that. What I think is happening, what could cause such a strong downdraft here? Well, you may say, rain, frictional drag from hydrometeors, but I think it's pressure. I think what happens is you get a very, very strong pressure gradient that gets sort of inverted and you causing a strong downdraft. Things don't get lined up right anymore and you just get that huge, huge downdraft. But that's just my theory. I haven't looked at the data enough yet. Okay, so for the remainder of my talk, I'm going to talk about a 20-meter simulation, only some preliminary results, focusing primarily on the tornado because as you'll see, at 20 meters, the tornado looks even more physically realistic. You see the multiple vortex nature of a tornado much better. It actually breaks down into a bona fide multiple vortex tornado. And I will let that run. So here's our cloud field, 20 meters. That's an anticyclonic tornado that is dissipating at the time. I'm well into the simulation. And then boom, there's our tornado. I will zoom in a bit, but this is fascinating. I mean, this is getting scary real. You're starting to see suction vortices show up in here. You're starting to see a lot of the variability that you've seen in many videos of supercells and tornadoes. And I'll zoom in a bit and compare to some observations shortly, but it's really hard to see because I'm speeding it up. But that kind of variation, they can see the multiple vortices, as you can see clear air between the cloud. All I'm showing is cloud and rain here, nothing else. The clouds are forming, the vortex is forming due to the pressure drop. So you see these features, and in a second I'm going to superimpose an observation from the side of a highway of an EF4 tornado that occurred 2 years ago in Illinois of some guy who got stuck on the side of the road. But you know, this gives me some confidence that our results are pretty good. So here's a real EF4 tornado. This guy is lucky to be alive. He just happened to be in the wrong place at the wrong time. But I kind of put these side by side to show you the similarities. You'll also see the multiple vortices pop out here and there. You'll see brief instances of clear air. There's one right there. There's one, and there's another one coming up. But you're seeing the same thing in our simulation. And there's one right about there. There you see a vortex. So hey, I think we're on the right track, okay? And I may be understating things a little bit, but the truth is, you know, nobody's really done this kind of work before, and I'm very, very hesitant to draw too many conclusions, especially with the 20-meter simulation, because we've only really begun to look at it. So to close things off in the next 5 minutes or so, I want to show you some more animations from the 20-meter simulation. So this is going to go through tornado genesis. Again, why is this persistent anticyclonic vortex here? And there's a recent paper that's come out on this. It's uncommon, but certainly not unprecedented, to have anticyclonic tornadoes in cyclonic right-moving supercell thunderstorms. And this one that does forms in the exact place you'd expect it to form in those cases. But it is a bit nerve-wracking to have a tornado, an anticyclonic tornado in this simulation when, you know, they are pretty rare, but there it is. Now, this is our cyclonic one. The genesis is a bit different in the 20-meter simulation, and here I'm just looking at a higher value of vorticity so you can see the tornado structure better. And I sort of have to go forward in leaps and bounds so I don't run too much video, but you know, you're gonna start to really see the multiple vortexes just churning around. It looks just like you would expect it. This is just showing more vorticity, capturing more of the lower vorticity thresholds, and it looks pretty darn good. Here I'm just looking at pressure deficit. So these are just surface slices of the pressure perturbation, focusing on negative regions. So we have a pressure drop in these little guys of like 150 hectopascals. You know, that's like 1/7 of one atmosphere. You know, so there's a lot of rotation drawing air out of that. So we see these embedded vortices around this larger scale tornado, and it's like a swarm of blue things. I don't know. It just goes and goes. Very complex, very chaotic. And here's just looking at vorticity instead of pressure to show you both the positive and the negative. You'll see a few negative guys in there, here and there. But by and large, it's a multiple vortex tornado. And it's when I was at the Severe Local Storms Conference in Portland, Oregon last November, the day after Election Day in America. Okay, that was a fun talk to give, by the way. Anyway. Never hold the conference during election week again, please. So anyway, I saw a talk by Josh Werman, I think it was, who was showing field data from the 31 May 2013 EF5 tornado in El Reno, Oklahoma. If you want to see a tornado move to El Reno, you'll get hit by one eventually. And it looked just like this. I was really, really gratified by the fact that this sort of angry swarm of things and this sort of chaotic evolution was seen in his data as well. Okay, so coming to the end, my parting thoughts, you can do this now. We can do this. We, the scientific community, there's a lot of moving parts involved in these simulations. There's a lot of stuff I haven't talked about you know, how I got the data to work, how I managed to volume render all this stuff. That was the sort of boring stuff, but for some reason I liked the boring stuff, so I went ahead and did it. No one else was doing it, so I did it. And then I had my simulation. The simulation was the nail biter, because we had all our tools in place but no simulation, but we managed to get it. So you can do this. we are now running full physics simulations at resolutions approaching, say, the earlier chamber studies, the earlier numerical chamber studies, like the Welland chamber and stuff. We're not quite there yet, but that's kind of cool, I think. I think this is a better way to do it, but it's a very expensive way to do it. So all these funny acronyms, streamwise vorticity current, vertical vortex sheet, streamwise vorticity sheet, surface vorticity sheet, the parade of vortices, all that stuff, that we have a whole bunch of stuff to analyze. And I wish I had more quantitative results to show you today, but we got a grant review to actually pay us to do it. Well, hopefully things will turn out. Of course, do these things exist in nature? I hope they do. I would hate to think that I went through all this effort to make a tornado if it's like wrong. I'm pretty sure that the model's doing a good job. It's made it through the peer review process. I think we're probably on the right track. You know, I want to not just study this one event, this 24 May 2011 storm. I want to look at other events. We're proposing to look at 31 May 13, Joplin, Missouri, Tuscaloosa, Alabama. These are these big high-end breakouts that occurred. 2011 was a banner year for big tornadoes in the United States. We had Joplin, we had El Reno, we had Tuscaloosa, all within a few weeks. It was just a terrible year. But we're going to look at more environments. One thing I haven't spent much time talking about is the extreme sensitivity of the results to initial conditions. I'll tell you another thing to show you how sensitive the simulation is. I cannot reproduce this simulation bit perfect anymore. The reason is I conducted this simulation about, say, a year and a half ago on the Blue Water supercomputer. Now, I compiled the model with some optimizations, which is what you want to do so it runs fast. Well, they've upgraded the compilers, they've upgraded the operating system, and now when I start the simulation and I look at the data that's coming out even before the simulation runs, the least significant bits are different on some of my input data. So game over, right? I mean, you know the Lorentzian butterfly flapping their wings is happening in this simulation. So I can go back and try to reproduce this and I get a different result. Sometimes I don't get a long track EFI even. Okay, so the sensitivity issue is one that's it's both infuriating and also fascinating to me, because if there really is this built-in chaotic nature to tornadoes, that's we need to know this because we're trying to forecast them. And if we can, I think we need to do ensembles of simulations of this nature in order to get a feel for the spectrum of possibilities that occur in any given environment. Because what meteorologists really want to do is they want to say, here's our environment, here's an atmospheric sounding, like the thing we initialized CM1 with. What's going to happen just based on that initial condition? And I'm saying, we need to do probabilistic studies to say this environment produces this type of storm, but it's so sensitive that I'm not sure we're going to ever get there, but we're going to try. So with that, I will be happy to take any questions you might have. Thank you.
There's quite an extensive literature. It's probably not mainstream, but quite a few people have noted a correlation between tornadoes and the jet stream, or especially the jet stream.
The polar jet?
The jet stream.
Okay.
Yeah. You don't include any of that in there, or you just don't have a resolution for it? You don't think it's important? Or?
Oh, sure, it's important. The jet is sort of built into the sounding. See, we have a horizontally homogeneous base state, so the winds are at every level, they're frozen. Okay, so we don't have any of that variability. Yes, having the jet and you know the trough and all that stuff lined up, if I could do that, I would. But we don't have we currently cannot do that.
But you go to 20 kilometers, so the 20 kilometers is just a sort of a boundary that you can run your simulations in?
Yeah, the sounding that I got initially went to 16 and I extended it up to 20. I added some to get into the triple pause long enough so that the energy from the updraft was dissipated correctly, right? So you have your overshooting top and the energies, the gravity waves are propagated. But what you're getting at is the environmental heterogeneities that are the focus of synoptic meteorology. And if I could run this simulation within a more realistic synoptic scale environment, I'd do it. Mm. But it's actually to our advantage to not do that for these initial simulations because it removes some degrees of freedom. Because the environment is frozen, and the winds aren't changing with time in the base state, then we at least have taken away one other confounding factor.
So if I had data that showed a strong correlation between the tornadoes and the jet stream, you wouldn't sort of poo-poo and push it?
Well, when you say a correlation, I mean, the jet is always there. There's times, are you talking about certain like, morphological features of the jet,
yeah.
or the exit yeah. regions, or the
particularly the divergence.
Divergence, sure. Well, the divergence is going to help to help keep that updraft going. You know,
but I'm just wondering whether that could be the trigger. You say you're very sensitive to your conditions.
Yes.
Nudge from below, but I'm feeling if you nudge from above, you might have more reliability.
Well, I'll tell you what. The first time I ran the simulation, when I told you I filled in the top 4 kilometers, I did it wrong. I actually. Because we, you know, you're trying to fill in data. I wanted to create a tropopause. Well, I ended up messing up the lapse rate a little bit. And then when I went back to fix it, I ran the simulation again. I didn't get a tornado. Now, I got the tornado back. I don't want to get into that. But my point being is, you know, it's sensitive to everything. But when you say the jet stream, there is no jet stream in the simulation. There's just a layer where you have those winds that would be there. You don't have any if you don't have a jet, you need to have variation horizontally, right? You need to have that. We're just capturing the sounding that was adjacent to the storm and letting it go. At some point, we'll hopefully be able to run these simulations where we're capturing more of the environmental variability, and then we can look at things like the jet. Sure.
Really impressive work. Both research and graphics and simulation. My question is, you said that simulations are very sensitive to initial conditions.
Yes.
Did you try maybe test sensitivity to different microphysics schemes or some other schemes? And yep. Similarly.
Yep. Sensitive? Okay. We have thus far. I've tried just about everything you can imagine. I've tried a single moment microphysics scheme. Now, when I say sensitivity, I get the basic same supercell. Okay, the supercell looks about the same. The tornado does or doesn't form. So it's these small scale variations. I've tried putting surface roughness in. This is mostly a free slip simulation, which has been kind of controversial because tornadoes aren't supposed to form in free slip environments, but I don't want to go down that road in the remaining time that we have. I tried sensitivity to turbulence closure scheme. We ended up with Smagorinsky, which is a diagnostic TKE scheme. We have a prognostic TKE scheme that I use. When I turned that one on, the tornado didn't form, but in the 20 meter run, it did. It's crazy. What else have we tried? We tried fifth order advection versus sixth order advection for the horizontal, and then adding a diffusion term, a smoothing term. So yes, we have. In fact, some of our proposed work is to explore the planetary space more and make some sense of this. Because my gut feeling from doing these simulations is that there's just issues of timing involved. And those issues of timing are like when you get the SVC kicking in and when those cyclonic vortices all kind of come together. Now, what determines that? That stuff going on in the precipitation field, it's falling a certain way, it's spreading out, little tiny things changing. So it may turn out that these sensitivities are due to other things that are going to be very difficult to forecast. But we haven't done that work yet, and I look forward to doing it because that's...
Follow-up question.
Sure.
Is the same sensitivity, does it hold for downbursts too?
No, downbursts, easy to make a downburst. You'll get sensitivity in downbursts to the environment, such as how deep the boundary layer is, the wind shear in the boundary layer. But the sensitivities are much easier, I think, to understand physically, because a downburst is essentially, if you strip it all the complexity away, it's a cold blob of air or a dense blob of air that hits the ground. There's different ways to get the dense blob to form, and there's different shapes and things, but the sensitivity in downbursts will be like, at what height did the maximum wind occur? What was the maximum wind speed? How far away was the center of the downdraft axis? Those sensitivities, yeah, and there are sensitivities, but not do we get a downburst? No, we always get a downburst.
Thanks.
Yeah.
I have a question.
Sure.
Your simulated tornado was like stationary?
Well, I'm moving the model domain with the storm. I just got really good at getting that velocity just right. So it's moving at like, 20 meters per second towards the northeast. I'm just moving the domain with the whole storm. Okay, so it's not stationary. I don't have any plots that show the tornado track ground relative, but I've been moving the camera with the storm, if you think of it. But when we do the simulation, we translate the box with the storm. And you have to estimate that translation velocity, and that's another thing that you can do sensitivity tests to. But essentially, we're moving the box with the storm. And the tornado is attached to the storm, so it generally stays in one place, ground relative.
I actually have a question about
sure.
the maintenance. One of the things that's always interested me is how the tornado itself is spinning faster than any speed around it, mm-hmm. right at the edge of the tornado.
Right.
So this notion of what's maintaining the tornado once it forms, I've tried to think of it as kind of a fluid machine that's pulling in energy, and it's pulling this energy across it, and it's driving it just like a turbine without a rotor.
Sure. Yeah, that's the one way to look. I mean, we are seeking one of the end results of this work. I hope from this simulation is that we can come up with a conceptual model that will have that will be sort of like what you just said. If we can actually find this thing. But yeah, I mean, essentially, what's surprising to me is that the updraft velocities, only say 50, 100 meters above the ground, are very strong in the updraft of the supercell, before the tornado forms. And I think a lot of the assumptions built into tornado genesis are that, there needs to be a downdraft to provide the vorticity to kick off the tornado. And technically, yes, there's downdrafts all over the place, creating a lot of this horizontal variation. But the downdrafts are way far away. The vorticity is already in place, and it's being scooted in to underneath the updraft. So the role of downdrafts in tornado genesis and maintenance, et cetera, is something that I think we're going to look at very carefully. But you did see some sections of the simulation where things look pretty steady-ish during the maintenance phase. And maybe we could like bracket a 5-minute period and just say, okay, what's going on at this 5-minute period? Is there, what's the balance of energy? What's going on?
Yeah, so because the velocity field, it's the slow in the middle, and then it gets really, really high.
Really high.
Across, and then it,
and then it slopes
again,
down again.
And that's
right.
Where everything's kind of coming in.
Yep. Yeah. But don't forget the vertical motion. It's incredibly strong on the outside of that downdraft, which is like 40 meters per second. You have like an equivalent 50 meter per second updraft along with that rotation. So. Yeah. Oh, yeah, you can.
Yeah, so following to that, so this like, it's like sucking the air from the surrounding, right? Like, how fast is this air? Like, is it half the speed of the tornado or something? Or?
No, less than that. So if our tornado churns along about 120 meters per second, the inflow near the surface is like at 40 to 45 meters per second. So where's the remaining energy coming from, right?
Yeah, that's what I have to say.
Right, where is it coming from?
Yeah.
And that's a good question. And really, we have to look at the updraft. The updraft, I mean, we have instantaneous updraft winds of 150 meters per second. So that means if you can get the air to go up that fast, you can get it to go around that fast too. Okay, so there's turbulence and there's things going on in here that are definitely not smooth and steady state or high, even close to hydrostatic. So there's no hidden source of energy that we've missed. It's in there. We just need to interpret it and figure out what's going on. We haven't done that yet.
One more question. Like, so let's say the diameter is like 400 meters.
Sure.
The surrounding area which you are sucking the air from, how big?
Well, here's a good... Let me go back to one of my...
I'm a water structure engineer, so that's why.
I know what you guys are getting at. Like, there's portions of this, like, okay.
How does it seem like it's big?
It's... Yeah, here's our tornado. So how would you, and this is why I'm like, how would we design a simple model that has baryclinicity in it but doesn't have to have this whole thing? And I don't know, there's a lot of fans and flumes and but yeah, the air is coming from, I mean, you can see this whole area, the air is screaming in, and it's being lifted at the same time. Remember, the updraft is over this whole image. There's a giant updraft parked over this, basically. So this, and that updraft is just sucking air upwards at it. With a huge velocity. It doesn't take long. You go 100 meters into the air and you're already, 30, 40 meters per second. It's crazy. So yeah, I don't know. That's a good question and something I'm gonna be thinking of. And maybe you guys can think of something and send me an email. Maybe we'll, I don't know. This is a good question. I know it's important to engineers. I wouldn't have even brought that up if I hadn't been working with Eric for all these years and I'm trying to think more like an engineer. It's making my brain hurt sometimes, but I'm trying to because I mean this is important work and it would be nice if we could come up with a model,
Yeah, Gerna?
Yeah.
Along the same line of discussion, what's your opinion about this classification? For example, you named it EF tornado.
Yeah.
Like, it's a very approximate classification.
Oh, the enhanced Fujita scale?
Yes.
Well, remember why we have the scale. The scale exists because we've got the damage, we've got the path, and we want to understand the tornado that formed it. I think it's terrible, honestly. I would rather we had Doppler radars everywhere and we could just measure the winds directly. I think that the enhanced Fujita scale is an improvement over the original Fujita scale in that there's more breadth of damage indicators and you've got a whole lot of different things to look at, but we're doing the best we can with what we've got, and you know, sometimes a tornado will hit almost an open field with a tree in it. And if unless it hits that tree, you may not be able to actually get its enhanced Vegeta argument because you've just got grass scour, you know? So we're doing the best we can with what we've got. And I wish we could improve upon it, but really I just wish we could observe these better. But
yes, why ask that question? It's for such a high resolution simulation.
Yeah.
When you name it EF scan, it was too approximate name.
The only reason I use the only reason I use the EF scale is usually when I'm talking to meteorologists, they know that's a top end. But really, the winds EF5 is 90 meter per second minimum threshold. Okay, this tornado produces sustained winds of 110-120 meters per second. So it's well into the EF5 region. But yes, the reason I use the enhanced Vegeta scale on a simulation where it's really not appropriate is just to give people the right context. That's the only reason I do it, because that's the way meteorologists think of tornadoes.
A couple things. First of all, just a comment about the current image that's on the screen. What I'm seeing there is there seems to be a strong anti-symmetric pattern between the two twin. Yeah, right there.
Yep, it looks like a looks like a bow echo almost. You can even see it better earlier on, like right there, right?
Yeah.
What's up with that, right?
Yeah.
And this guy, and again, this is, looking at the observations, this is exactly where it should be if it's going to be there at all.
Yeah.
But and if you follow this vortex up, there seems to be somewhat of a mirror symmetry. Not very mirror, but somewhat. This guy is attached to the updraft. The anticyclonic tornado is always a skinny little thing. It's not as robust and doesn't have the 20 meter simulation, it does have some two-celled structure. But I gotta worry about this guy first before I even think about this guy. It'd make me crazy. But there is some interesting things to be. Do you have any insight into this? Do you have any thoughts? Why is it there? Some people have talked about vortex arching, how maybe they're part of a vortex. No, I don't know. I don't know yet. I just haven't looked at that yet. But it's there.
It seems to have its own little parade.
It has its own sort of, but you, yeah.
Well, it's not quite.
It's not as, it's sort of much more chaotic, and it comes and it goes. See, then it becomes sort of a bundle, and then there's a downdraft, there it is again. So it's much less structured or much less, and sometimes it's not there at all. Well, there it is. It's shedding all this vorticity now. And this is the one, I skip ahead, I think, but this is the one that it ends up, that's cool. Whee! Yeah. And it gets, here's another one. So this, that's definitely something we have to address. We're just now starting to go through the quantitative portion of this, but.
So my second question is, can you just remind me again what the vertical velocity is in the form of the tornado? There's a strong updraft around the outside, but is there a downward component right at the core?
Yes, and I can show you that right, where did I have it? It's about 20-30 meters per second, 30-40 meters per second. Oh, where is it? I have one slide that shows that. If I can get there really quick. Here we go, right here. Okay, let me go back a little bit, because I have the scale. So in the center image, the blue goes down to, 40 meters per second is where it goes. So yes, it is a classic two-celled tornado, where in between these intertwined vortices, which are both cyclonic, you have downward motion compensating. And that is a classic two-cell tornado. It starts out, but that doesn't exist until after a while. So it transitions from a single cell to a two-cell, and that's interesting. It didn't start out as a two-cell. I think real tornadoes sometimes do start out as two-cell. You watch the actual somebody footage of a tornado. Sometimes they start out with multiple vortices even. This one starts out as a single little thin vortex, and it spreads out and sort of transitions.
What are the amounts of helicity in these tornadoes? Or the better question, what is the minimum amount of helicity on these tornadoes that your models can detect?
When you talk about the helicity of the tornado or of the environment that produced it?
Environment, how's that?
So I would go, I don't have a slide for the sounding. Storm relative helicity in the environment that forms a supercell, very high. It's I have it in the paper. It's 400, 500 meters squared per second or something. It's very high. The helicity in the tornado, I could calculate it, but It's high. But the environmental, usually meteorologists look at the storm relative environmental helicity, and it's off the charts for an event like this. It's no surprise that it produces a big tornado. But if you want actual numbers, check out the BAMS article. They're listed in the sounding parameters.
Any other questions?
Well, then I'd like to thank Dr. Orr for the party gift.
Oh, cool. Thank you.
It's not a tornado.
Absolutely. Thank you.